Good morning, everyone. A warm welcome to you all for VTU e-learning session. Myself, Sanjay Kumar C. Gaure, working as professor in BKIT Bhalki. I'll be handling microcontroller subject with subject code 18EC46. During the course of this, we'll be discussing the objectives of this course, why we need to study this subject, and what are the main objectives of this subject, microcontroller subject. The first objective of this course is we should understand the difference between the three entities. That is, one is microprocessor, the microcontroller, and then the embedded microcontrollers. So student basically need to understand what are these three things, what are the similarities, and what are the differences between these three. Then also the other objective is we should know the basic architecture of 8051 microcontroller, how exactly the microcontroller architecture looks like and how it works, what are the different components we have in the architecture of 8051 microcontroller, like there is a ALU, arithmetic and logical unit, there are registers, there are IO ports, there are timers, and then the counters. Along with this, the student also need to understand and need to able to write the program in two languages. One is assembly level language, which is basically used in microcontroller. Also the same programs we need to able to write in C. The next course objective is we need to understand what is interrupt system of 8051 and how to use these interrupts for various applications. Also, the one more objective is we need to understand the operation of timers, counters, and the serial ports which are there in 8051, because we need to use these three things for different applications. And finally, the last objective of this course is how to interface the external memory and the IO devices to the 8051 microcontroller using its the input output ports. So basically these are the course objectives one needs to study during the semester. This is what the syllabus of 8051 microcontroller. As we all know that according to CBCA scheme, every subject has got the 5 modules. So similarly here also we have 5 modules, module 1 through module 5. So in module 1, I will be discussing about 8051 microcontroller. Particularly, we'll be discussing what is meant by microprocessor, what is meant by microcontroller, and then we'll be comparing microprocessor and then the microcontroller. And we also studying the what is meant by embedded systems and what is meant by embedded microcontrollers. Once we are done with this, we'll be studying detailed architecture of 8051, right? As we have already said in the course objectives, we'll be discussing about ALU, we'll be discussing about registers, register banks, program status words, program counter, and then we'll be discussing about the different 40 pins of 8051, what are the functions of each pin, and then we'll be discussing about the available IO ports functions of 8051. And then we'll be discussing about internal memory organization, that is basically RAM and ROM. And then if required for some of the application, the existing memory which is there on chip may not be sufficient. So we need to interface the external memory, both ROM and RAM. We'll be discussing all these things in module 1. Coming to module 2, we'll be discussing about the instruction set. Basically, the instruction set is tells the programmer how to write the programs. So once we know what are these instruction sets, what are its applications, what happens to the different flags, then only we'll be able to write the programs. So we'll start our discussion with addressing modes. Basically, the addressing mode is what the way in which the operands are specified. There are different types of addressing modes are there. We'll be discussing all those addressing modes in detail with example. Then we'll be discussing different instruction set which are categorized into many types. One of them is data transfer instructions. As name indicates, in data transfer instructions, the data will be moved from one place to another place. So we'll be discussing the instructions which falls under data transfer category. Then we'll be discussing the arithmetic instructions like addition, subtraction, add with carry, subtract with carry, compare instructions. And then we'll be discussing logical instructions like AND, OR, all these logical instructions. Then further we'll be discussing branch instructions, right? Depending on the condition of the flags, right? There are some conditions will be set like jump on carry, jump on no carry. We'll be discussing all those instructions under branch instructions. Then we'll be discussing about bit manipulation instructions. Each bit can be manipulated in 8051. So we'll be discussing the instructions which falls under bit manipulation. Then we'll be writing the simple programs in the assembly language to use these all above instructions which we have studied to fill the importance of all those instructions. Now coming to module 3. In module 3 we'll be discussing about the stack. What is meant by stack? What are the advantages of a stack in 8051? Along with that, we'll be discussing input-output port interfacing, and then also we'll be discussing programming. So 8051 stack, and then we'll be discussing about stack and subroutine instructions, which basically we need to use, like instruction like push and pop. Then we'll be writing the assembly language programs on subroutines involving the loops. Then we'll also be discussing the program in which we will be interfacing a simple switch and LED to IO ports to switch on off LED with respect to switch status. Further, in module 4, we'll be discussing about timers and serial port. So we'll start our discussion with how many timers and how many counters we have, how many different modes we have in 8051. We'll be discussing about the operation of both timers as well as counters. Then we'll be writing a program, assembly language program, to generate a pulse using mode 1 and a square wave using mode 2 on a port pin. Then we'll be discussing about the serial communications, wherein we'll be discussing about what is meant by serial communication, what is meant by parallel communication, advantages, disadvantages. So we'll start our discussion with basics of serial data communication. Then we'll be discussing the standard, RS-232 standard, 9-pin, RS-232 signals. Then we'll be discussing about simple serial port programming in assembly and also in C language to transmit a message and to receive the data serially. Whereas in the last module, we'll be discussing about what are the interrupts, what is meant by interrupts, what are its use, and then we'll be discussing about some of the interfacing applications of 8051. So to start with the 8051 interrupt, 8051 assembly language programming to generate an external interrupt using a switch. Then 8051 C program to generate a square waveform on a port pin using timer interrupt. Interfacing 8051 to ADC, which stands for analog to digital converter, 0804. Then DAC, which is nothing but digital to analog converter. Then LCD and stepper motor interfacing using assembly language. So this is basically the whole syllabus of 8051 from module 1 through module 5. And the textbook for this subject are, one is the 8051 microcontroller and embedded system using assembly and C, authored by Muhammad Ali Mazadi. The publisher is Pearson. The other textbook is the 8051 microcontroller by Kenneth J. Ayla, third edition, by Thomas Learning. And along with this, we have some reference books also. So the two reference books are the 8051 microcontroller based embedded systems by Manish K. Patel, Macro Hall publication, and the last reference book is Microcontroller Architecture, Programming, Interfacing and System Design by Raj Kamal, again which is from Pearson Education. Now, once we go through the course objective and then the syllabus, next is what the course outcome, right? So these are the few of the course outcome. That means once we complete this subject at the end of this semester, all the students, right, must be able to explain what are the difference between microprocessor and microcontroller, along with that embedded microcontroller. The student should need to explain the architecture of 8051 microcontroller, how it works, what are the different parts we have in 8051 microcontroller. Along with this, the student must be able to know and explain how to interface 8051 to external memory, and then the different instruction sets of 8051. As we have discussed in the syllabus, there are different instructions which are categorized into many ways, like one is data transfer instruction, logical instructions, and then so on. Right. Along with this, once this course is completed, right, the student should be able to write assembly language program using 8051 instruction set. Different programs will be there. The student should be able to write the program. Along with this, the student should be also able to explain what is interrupt system, what are the uses, and then how it operates. Along with this, the student should also know the operation of the timers, the counters, and then the serial port of 8051, along with the different modes also. And then the next course outcome is student needs to able to write the assembly language program to generate timings and waveforms using 8051 timers. Also, students should be able to write a program to send and receive the serial data using 8051 serial port, and then generate an external interrupt using a switch. And then students should be also able to write assembly language program to generate a square wave on 8051 IO port. Along with the assembly language program, the student should also be able to write the C program to send and receive the data using 8051 serial port. Then interfacing simple switches, simple LEDs, ADC, LCD, and stepper motor to 8051 using IO ports. So these are the few of the course outcome, right? So student needs to understand the basics of microcontroller, needs to listen carefully, it needs to go through what is being taught, and once the course is completed, all the students must be able to know all these things, should be able to write the program in both ALP assembly language program as well as C programs. So with this, we'll start our discussion on module 1, right? As we have discussed, module 1 basically will start with a brief introduction. According to syllabus, we have not studied what is microprocessor. So briefly, I'll go through the journey of microprocessor, or what you can say journey of digital electronics, and then we'll come to microcontroller. Then once we study microcontroller, once we know what is microprocessor, then we should be able to differentiate between microprocessor and then microcontroller. Then further, we'll be discussing the embedded systems and embedded microcontrollers. These are the further versions of microcontroller. Then we'll be discussing in detail the architecture of 8051, which basically consists of, as we have discussed, arithmetic and logical unit, which consists of different registers like register A, register B. There are four register banks we have in 8051. Further, each bank has got 8 registers, so you can say that total 32 registers are there. Then there is a program counter, then there is a stack pointer. Then we'll be discussing the pin diagram of 8051. That pin diagram basically explains what all the functions we have got, like address pins, data pins, then control pins, IO ports, timers, counters, the frequency required, the power supply required. We'll be discussing all those things in detail in pin diagram. Then we'll be discussing about the internal memory organization of 8051, right? The amount of RAM and amount of ROM, what we have on chip in 8051. And then if it is required, right? Sometimes the on-chip RAM and on-chip ROM may not be sufficient for programs, bigger programs, then we need to use the external memory. So if you want to use the external memory, then we should know how to interface the external memory to 8051, that is ROM as well as RAM. So all these things we'll be discussing in module 1. So before getting into what is microcontroller and its architecture and its applications and then the pin diagram, briefly we will go through the introduction part, right? So the learning outcome of this today's discussion is what the student should know the number system and the conversion. This we have studied in basic electronics as well as in digital electronics. There are different number systems and then the conversion from one type to another type. Also we have studied logic gates, different logic gates in basic electronics. So briefly we will revise the logic gates. Also the learning outcome of this today's session is understand the operation of different types of adders, like half adder, full adder, parallel adders, then decoders, and then different types of flip-flops. Then we need to understand the different terminologies which are used in a computer. Then also we need to familiarize with the different types of buses, like address bus, data bus, control bus. What is the significance of these buses and use of these buses? And then understand the working of a central processing unit, arithmetical logical unit, the program counter, and then the instruction decoder. So to start with, as we all know that there are different types of number systems are there. Decimal number system, binary, octal, and then the hexadecimal number systems. In a day-to-day activity, we use decimal number systems. But as computer doesn't understand these decimal numbers, or it can understand only zeros and ones, so we need to have the elementary knowledge of binary number system. By means only two, 0 and 1. And then hexadecimal number system, which are 16. So definitely there is a relation between binary and then the hexadecimal numbers, right? So we know these different types of number systems. Also we know how to convert a number from one type to another type, right? Say for example, decimal to binary is what? Successfully divide by 2. Then decimal to hexadecimal, successfully divide by 16. Then binary to hexadecimal, make a group of 4 bits and then write its equivalent. Whereas hexadecimal to binary is what? Look at the number and write its equivalent 4 bits. So I'm sure that we all know the number systems and the conversion from one type to another type. Then we also studied different logic gates like OR gate, AND gate, NOT gate, NOR gate, NAND gate, exclusive OR gate and exclusive NOR gate, right? We have studied all these gates using truth table. Among these gates, NOR gate and NAND gates are known as what? Universal gates, because using only NAND and using only NOR, the rest of the gates can be implemented. Further, briefly we'll go through the adders, half adder. There are only 2 inputs and there are 2 outputs, right? Sum and carry, whereas in full adder, which is basically used to add 3 bits. So we have got 3 inputs like A, B, C and 2 outputs, sum and carry. If the number of bits are more, if you want to add more than 3 bits, then we need to go for parallel adder. Then we have studied encoders and then the decoders, which are basically used in digital electronics and then also in computers. And then the different types of flip-flops like JK flip-flop, SR flip-flop, T flip-flop. And then if you look at the diagram of a computer, right, what may be there inside the computer, I'll be showing that in the next slide. There are some unit of the data set, right? If you're talking about only a single bit, either 1 or 0, then it is known as what bit? Bit stands for binary digit, right? And then if I have a 4 bits together, then it is known as what? A nibble or half a byte. And then if I have a combination of 8 bits, then it is known as what? Byte. If you have a 16 bits or 2 bytes, then it is known as what? Word. If you have a 32 bits, then it is known as what? Double word. And then in a computer terminology, many things are used like kilobyte, right? Which is nothing but 2 to the power of 10 bytes. Then we have a megabyte, then which is nothing but 2 to the power of 20 bytes or over 1 million bits, then gigabyte which is nothing but 2 to the power of 30 bytes or over 1 billion, and then there is a terabyte which is nothing but 2 to the power of 40 bytes or over 1 trillion. So in most of the cases when you are talking about computer or you are talking about mobile phone, right, these terminology will comes into picture. Now have a look at the internal organization of a computer, right? So we all know that there is a CPU which is nothing but central processing unit, and then memory which may consist of RAM and then the ROM. RAM stands for random access memory and ROM stands for read only memory, and then the different peripherals, right? Few examples is what: monitor, printer, then mouse, then scanner. Many things can be interfaced to the CPU. So basically, if you are talking about CPU, as it stands for central processing unit, so all the processing will take place in the CPU, right? It execute the information which is basically stored in the memory. Then there are input output devices, right? These basically provides a means of communicating with the CPU, because CPU will process the information. But for processing, it needs to get the data from memory, right? It needs to get the input from keyboard. It needs to display the information on the monitor. So the CPU has to communicate with the all the connected or interfaced I/O devices. As we are looking for the memory, right? As we have discussed, we have a random access memory and we have a read-only memory. So this is what you call is an internal organization of a computer. Now, if you get into the CPU in detail, right? CPU is connected to memory and I/O, right? Through strips of wire called bus, right? In the previous slide, we have seen the diagram wherein the CPU is connected to RAM, ROM, as well as the peripherals like monitor, then the keyboard and all those things. Right. Basically, the connection is done through a bus for the communication purpose. There are three types of different buses are there. They are known as what: address bus, data bus, and then the control bus. And each bus will do a specific function here. So if you look at the address bus, right, as we are saying that the computer will execute or computer will process the information, but from where we'll get the data, right? So it will be getting the data from the memory or the connected I/O device. So to get the information from the memory or I/O device, or to store the data in memory or I/O device, right, we need to have the address, right? So the address plays a very important role. The address assigned to given device must be unique, and it is unidirectional. The data bus, the movement of data is there. The CPU either gets data from the device or sends data to it. And then we have a control bus, right? If you're looking at the pin diagram of 8051, a few pins are used in a multiplexed format, right? The same pin can be used as address as well as for data. That means each pin will be doing multifunctioning. So for them and for the proper operation of a whole CPU, we need to have a control bus also. So it basically provides read or write signals to the device to indicate whether CPU is asking the information or it wants to store the information. Furthermore, a few things about address bus. If you have more addresses, right, then the larger number of devices that can be addressed. There are two important things: more number of address buses, more number of devices can be connected, and the more number of address lines basically tells us the amount of memory we can have, and that is given by 2 to the power of x, where x is the number of address lines. So if I have a x is equal to 2, then 2 to the power of 2 is 4, right? So 2 to the power of 2 is what means 4 means what? Only 4 bytes of addressable memories are available. So if I have a 24 address lines, for example, if a CPU has 24 address lines, then 2 to the power of 24, which gives us 64 megabytes. So this is the memory size which we can have in the hard disk. So nowadays when we are talking about memory in terms of GB and TB, we can have a more number of address lines. Again, if I have a more number of address lines, more address memory location is there, but always there will be disadvantages also. Each locations can have a maximum of 1 byte of data, since all general purpose CPUs are byte addressable. So for that purpose, the storage will be of only 1 byte. And as we have discussed, the address bus is a unidirectional. At a time, it can operate in only one direction. Whereas coming to data bus, right, as name indicates, it carries the data from CPU to the memory or to the IO device or vice versa. The more data buses available, the better is the CPU, right? That is the basic concept. That means you can visualize that the data bus is nothing but a highway lines, right? Earlier we used to have a single line, then the speed of the bus or trucks is very low. Now we can think about the 4 line, 6 line, 8 line highways, then the bus or trucks can move very faster way. So more number of data buses is always desirable, but at the same time you can see that the next line, if you have a more number of data buses, means what? The computer is more expensive, right? So this is a trade-off between what you want. The average size of data bus in CPU varies between 8 to 64, and also the difference between the address and data bus is, address bus is unidirectional, whereas data buses are bidirectional, and these buses are used to receive as well as to send the data. Also, the one more important parameter of data bus is what? The processing power of computer is related to size of the bus, right? If the size of the bus is more, then the processing power is more. For the CPU to process the information, right, we need to have the data either in RAM or ROM, which are known as what, the primary memory, right? And from this RAM and ROM, the CPU will get the information by generating the address, and it gets the data and it will process it. ROM, as we know that ROM stands for random read-only memory, which provides information that is fixed and then the permanent, right? So whatever we have in the ROM, read-only memory, right, this is fixed, you cannot change it. Whereas RAM stands for random access memory, which is not permanent, right? So here you can either write or read it. As we know that there are different operating systems are available. DOS is there, Windows is there, then Linux is there, and there are different application packages are also there. So CPU gets the information to be processed either from RAM or ROM. If it is not there in RAM and ROM, then we need to get it from the secondary memory, which is known as what, mass storage. And then further they will be transferred to the RAM. Then the computers, the CPU will be having the registers. Basically, the registers are used to store the data temporarily. So the CPU uses registers to store the information temporarily. The main advantage of using the register is what? The registers are there in the CPU itself. It is nearer to the ALU, arithmetic and logical unit. If the data is there in the memory, you need to generate the address, need to access the data from the memory, process it. It takes the more amount of time. Whereas if the data is there in the register, you can execute the same thing in a smaller amount of time. So address of the value to be fetched from memory. So again, it is a trade-off. If you are doing a calculation, if your answer or if your result is temporary, then use the registers. If your answer is permanent, then you go for the memory. So in general, the more and bigger the registers are better the CPU. If you have a more number of registers, then it is advantageable. Also, the capacity of the registers to execute the bits, right? So either registers can be of 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit or 16-bit. The meaning of 8-bit, meaning of 16-bit is what? At a time, it can operate on 8 bits. Right? It can store the 8 bits only. Whereas the disadvantage of having more and bigger register is what? The increased cost of the CPU. Right. Now, the one more important part of CPU is known as what? ALU, which is known as what? Arithmetic and logical units. As name indicates, the ALU will perform both these operations, arithmetic operations such as what? Addition, subtraction, multiplication, then division, and logical operations like ANDing, ORing, and not what you call complementing between the numbers. Also, it has got a program counter. As you can see that this basically program counter points to the address of the next instruction which is to be executed. Right? We are writing a program which consists of many instructions. Right? If currently an instruction is being executed by ALU, the program counter will point to the next instruction which is to be executed. Then one more important terminology, important part in the processor is what instruction decoder. As name indicates, it interprets the instruction, right? For example, we are writing a program for adding two numbers, right? So I'll use a instruction as add R0 comma R1. Here add is the operation. We need to add the two numbers, and those two numbers are there in registers known as what? R0 and then R1, right? So, but the computer, as they don't understand add, they understand only 0 and 1. So we need to decode that add into form in terms of say 0 and 1. So instruction decoder is also an important part in CPU. Right. So if you're getting into the what you call architecture of processor or a computer, right? So there is a CPU. Inside CPU, we have discussed many things. We have discussed ALU, arithmetic and logical unit. We have discussed different types of buses which are there in the CPU, like address bus, data bus, and then the control bus. If you look at the registers also, right? Registers, as we have said, that there are different types, size of registers which are available in the processors, like 8-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit, and then the 64-bit. So as we have discussed, if I have a microprocessor or a microcontroller of 8-bit, the microcontroller what we are studying in this semester, 8051, is an 8-bit microcontroller. Now here the meaning of 8-bit is what? At a time it can operate on 8 bits, and registers are also of 8 bit. That means the each registers, what all the registers we have in 8051, will store the 8 bit data or a byte. So you may be having doubt that if someone asks us to add two 16 bit numbers or two bytes, then whether it is possible in microcontroller or not, because the processing is also done on 8-bit, whereas registers are also of 8-bit. Then question comes, is it possible to process a 16 bits? Yes, obviously you can do it, but that can be done in two parts, right? So for example, if you want to add two 16-bit numbers, then you need to do that in two parts, right? Take the lower 8-bit, add them, store somewhere, and then take the higher 8 bits, add them, and then store it. So we'll be doing that in two stages, right? Then question comes whether 8-bit microcontroller is good or 16-bit or higher bit microcontroller is good. Obviously, as we have discussed, right, the higher the bit, it is very good, because if you compare 8-bit and then the 16-bit, right, obviously 16-bit microcontroller is very good because at a time it can operate on 64 bits. Right, obviously the registers will also be of 64 bits, so the processing will be faster. But again, the problem is what? As we have discussed, right, if you want to go for the higher bit microcontroller, then the cost will be increased. Then the other question comes is what? Whether you need to go for 8-bit microcontroller or 16-bit or 64-bit microcontroller. Again, don't have a definite answer for this. It depends on what application we are talking about. If your application is very small, if you're not bothered about the execution time, then go for 8-bit microcontroller. If your application is larger one and if you are bothered about the execution time, then you need to go for 64-bit. Then we need to ready for bearing the cost. The other important parameter is also what, as we have discussed, that the information can be stored in either registers, or you can store the information in the memory also, right? Further, you may be having doubt that whether to store the data in registers or to store the data in the main memory. Again, the most of the time the logic used is what, if you are writing a program and if the your answer is temporary, right, if your answer is temporary, then store those results in registers. Once you complete your whole program, and then once your result becomes permanent, then you can store it in the permanent memory locations. But advantage of using registers is there, because you can access the data in a faster way, and then you can process the information in a smaller amount of time. But if you want to use the memory, then again time taken will be more, because the CPU need to generate the address where exactly data is there. It need to generate the address. That information, the address information, will go to memory, right? From that memory, the data will be taken. It takes back to the ALU and it will operate it. So for generating the address, for the movement from CPU to the memory and back from memory to CPU, it takes a time, right? So as you can say that this is a trade-off between registers and then the main memory. Okay, so we have discussed all these things, right? So if you are looking at the summary of today's discussion, right, so what we have done in today's class is we have discussed the different types of number systems: decimal number system, binary number system, octal number system, and then hexadecimal number system. Octal number system is one in which there are only 8 numbers are there, from 0 to 7. These 0 to 7 numbers can be represented using 3 bits from 000 to 111, right? The basic need of discussing and learning these number system is what? We should be able to know what are binary number system, what is hexadecimal number system, because these are the number systems which computer understands, zero signed ones, right? So hexadecimal numbers are from 0 to 9, right? It is similar to decimal numbers. In decimal also we have 0 to 9, and in hexadecimal also we have 0 to 9, and then from 9 the next number will be in hexadecimal is what, A, B, C, D, E, and then F. So if someone asks you to convert a given decimal number, like for example 15, and someone asks you to represent this in hexadecimal, right, as an electronic engineer, as we have studied this in basic electronics and digital electronics, right, F in hexadecimal is 1111, right? But you should know how to convert that F 15 into F, right? So 15, if you successfully divide by 2, we'll get as 1111, right? So 1111 representation is in binary, right? The same thing if you want to represent in hexadecimal, it becomes F, right? So you should be able to know this. The one important thing you need to keep in mind is what, the conversion from decimal to hexadecimal, right? For example, if a number is there and you are dividing by 16 and you are getting a remainder as 13, right, or remainder as 10, then you need to keep the equivalent of 10 in hexadecimal, right? So if you are looking at the table, if you remember the hexadecimal number systems, what we have is 10 is A in case of hexadecimal, 11 in binary, 11 in hexadecimal is B, 12 is C, So if you are converting a number from hexadecimal to binary, so you need to look at the remainder. If the remainder is less than 9, there is no worry, you need to keep that as it is. But if the remainder is more than 9, then you need to put that in terms of A, B, C, D, E and F, right? For example, if remainder you are getting as 14, then keep it as an E, okay? And then we have discussed different logic gates also, right? OR gate. OR gate, if you are looking at the table of OR gate, the output of OR gate is 1, always 1, even if 1 or more than 1 input is 1, or in other words, if both the inputs are 0, then only the output is 0, else it is 1. We also discussed AND gate, right? In AND gate, what we have discussed is, if both the inputs are 1, then only the output is 1, else it is 0. NOT gate, it is what complement, if input is 0, output will be 1. Then we have discussed NOR gate. NOR gate is nothing but OR and then NOT, right? So NOR gate table, if both the inputs are 0, 0, then only you'll get output 1, okay? And then in NAND gate is AND gate and then the NOT gate. Then we have a exclusive OR gate, and the exclusive OR gate is what? If both the inputs are different, then only we'll get the output, else no. Exclusive NOR is again exclusive OR and then the NOT gate. If both the inputs are same, then only you'll get the output. Further, we have discussed about the different types of adders, half adder, full adder, and then the parallel adders. So as we know that half adder has got only two inputs, A and B, two outputs, sum and carry. So we'll get sum is equal to A exclusive or B and carry is equal to A and B, right? The disadvantage of half adder is what? It can add only 2 bits at a time. Then the solution for half adder is what? Full adder. Full adder can be used for adding 3 bits. And then if the number of bits are more than 3, then we need to go for parallel adders, right? The decoders we have discussed, right? In the instruction decoder, we have discussed that, right? All the information needs to be converted in the form of zeros and ones. We have discussed flip-flops also, right? Different terminology we have discussed. Bit is 1 bit, nibble is 4 bits, word is 8 bits. Then there is a double word, which is 16 bits. And then there is a kilobyte, 10 to the power of 3, megabyte, 10 to the power of 6, gigabyte, 10 to the power of 9, and then terabyte, 10 to the power of 12. Then we also discussed different buses which are used in the computer, like address bus, data bus, and then the control bus. We have discussed the advantages and disadvantages of each one of these, right? As we have discussed, more number of address lines, more number of data bus are preferable. But at the same time, the cost of the computer will go up. So we need to trade off between these. Whereas control signals are required because for the operation of address, for the operation of data, we need to generate these control signals. Also, we have discussed the working of CPU, right? CPU basically has got arithmetic and logical unit, which will do arithmetic operations like addition, subtraction, logical operations. We also discussed about the program counter, which basically points to the instruction which is to be executed next. Then we have discussed about instruction decoder also. So this is all what we have discussed in first class. Next class we'll be discussing about, in the next class we'll be discussing about what are the difference between the microprocessor, microcontroller, and then the embedded system, right? Whether they are same or they are different. If they are same, what are the similarities? If they are different, what are the different things we have? Then we'll be discussing about the applications of embedded system, right? Nowadays, most of the time people are talking about embedded systems, right? So we need to look into the need for studying the embedded systems and what are its applications. And importantly, we'll be discussing about choosing a microcontroller, right? As we have known that there are different types of microcontrollers are there, 8-bit, 16-bit, and then there are different companies are there, and then different speed microcontrollers are there. So we need to discuss about different criterias, right? So once we know the different criterias, then only we'll be able to choose a microcontroller. This we'll be discussing in the next class. Right. Hope that you have followed today what we have discussed. Right. As I said that in today's class, most of the things what we have discussed is what we have studied in the previous semesters, in first or second sem basic electronics or third sem digital electronics. Thank you. Thank you very much.